This is a HeadGum Podcast.
Hey, buddy, the holidays are right around the corner, and while it's great to get gifts for the people you love, it's also a time to give back to those less fortunate. And I'm not just talking about people in need, but cats, too.
Wags, I rescued my cats, Wally and Irma, so I'm a big advocate for people rescuing kitties in need. Our next sponsor is a brand that Wally, Irma, and I love, mainly for their food, but also because they donate to the Humane Society.
This podcast is sponsored by Smalls. If you are a listener of this show, you know that Mitch's cats love Smalls.
That's right. Smalls cat food is protein-packed recipes made with preservative-free ingredients you'd find in your fridge, and it's delivered right to your door.
Smalls recently kicked off a partnership with the Humane Society. They've donated over $1 million worth of food to help cats through the Humane Society, and they even give you a chance to donate at checkout, whether you donate $3 for treats, $5 for vaccines, or $7 for spaying or neutering.
Wags, I don't know if you remember this. My old cat food used to stink.
I remember.
I come in, you say, "You stink." I'd say, "I know, it's the cat food. What can I do?" Well,
yeah.
Guess what? Not Smalls. Smalls doesn't stink. I can finally open a packet of cat food and not get nauseous. Plus, I actually recognize the ingredients in a packet of Smalls food.
The difference that Smalls makes is real. After making the switch to Smalls, 78% of cat owners reported their cats had shinier and softer fur, and 90% reported overall health improvements. That's a big deal.
And with Smalls, you can adjust or cancel anytime, easily skip shipments, switch up recipes, and add on goodies based on cats' needs and preferences.
Is your cat food giving back to cats in need? Smalls is. So if you want to give Smalls a try and ditch kibble forever, head to smalls.com/doughboys and use promo code doughboys at checkout for 50% off your first order plus free shipping. That's the best offer you'll find, but you have to use our code doughboys for 50% off your first order. One last time, that's promo code doughboys for 50% off your first order plus free shipping. Boston, Oregon? It nearly happened. It came down to a series of coin flips that took place in 1845 between Pacific Northwest pioneers William Overton and Francis W. Pettigrove, each of whom wanted to name a fledgling Pacific Northwest settlement after his New England hometown. It's difficult to fathom the asynchronous alternate reality where Oregon's NBA franchise is the Boston Trailblazers, and Fred Armisen's sketch series is called Bostonia. Would Boston, Oregon still have its much commented upon twee hipster quality? Or would the gravitational pull of the name alone have drawn it more toward the crasser, baser, rage-fueled character of the Massachusetts city? These hypotheticals will remain hypothetical because Pettigrove prevailed and the future metropolis would be named Portland. By the end of the 20th century, Portland, Oregon would easily surpass its main forefather in both population and cultural relevance, including developing a vibrant food scene. And the West Coast Portland is where cousins Kim and Tyler Malik opened an ice cream cart in 2011, based more on gumption than know-how. A brick and mortar soon followed, and today, the Stumptown Scoop Shop has 36 locations across the West Coast, plus restaurants in tourist epicenters like Las Vegas and Disney Springs, Orlando. The unique name of this artisan churning cousins collab derives from the raw materials used to produce the test batches of its original flavors. One might speculate that the alternate reality Boston, Oregon version would be called Pepper and Hay. But we don't live in that reality. This week on Doughboys, here on Earth Prime, Salt and Straw. Welcome to Doughboys, the podcast about chain restaurants. I'm Nick Weiger, along with my co-host, Buster Eaton, the spoon man, Mike Mitchell.
So, like this famous film, silent film
Throwback
star.
Throw back to the silent film era.
Yeah. That's my cat, Buster, was actually named after Buster Keaton.
Oh, that's cute.
Or Buster Douglas. One of the two. I don't know which one it was, actually.
James Buster Douglas, the heavyweight champion?
Yeah, it was one of the two. Okay. I forget which one it was. I think it was maybe Buster Keaton.
I would assume Buster Keaton.
It was a quiet cat, but it was also feisty. Well, I don't know if I'll ever solve this mystery, but oh, joyous day.
Oh, joyous day. That was sent in by Clay in North Carolina. Thanks for the laughs every week. RoastSpoonMan@gmail.com. Oh, joyous day.
I mean, the secret thing is that we're done for the year, you and I.
We're kind of on last day of school mode because this is our final record of 2023. Yeah. Even though this episode is coming out before a few other episodes.
Break your pencil.
Yes.
I guess you wanted to break everything. You know, return
the
your
studio down.
There you go.
Yeah. What will you do on the last day of school?
You know what I'd do. Settle some scores.
Fuck.
No, I usually last day of school, I just sort of like hanging out. I don't know, fucking whatever. The last day of school is so not a day. That's the thing. It's like there's no actual education going on.
Yes.
You're just kind of hanging out.
I told you that when my senior year, I had 30 or so gyms to make up. I've told you this before. And they were like, we'll wipe all your gyms clear if you can run a mile in under like 9 minutes or 8 minutes. And then I was like, okay. And I was with a bunch of other friends. And then my buddy Micus and Shankton, we all had to run it in under the time they set for us to have all of our gyms wiped out. And they were behind me pushing me around the gym so that I could like finish in time. And I think I did by like 10 seconds or so.
I mean, if it's 8 minutes, that's a relatively swift mile.
Yeah. Yeah, probably is 8 minutes or so. Pretty good. Let's see here, Wags. Howdy ho to Spoon Nation. This is the thing I can't even look at our guests.
I don't want to know what it is. I just like enjoying it cold.
It's our thing that we do when we, I got a new treadmill.
Wait, you bailed on it?
Oh,
You were about to do it and you bailed.
I did it. I said it. I said, howdy ho to Spoon Nation. I did the thing.
Well, you usually play a drop.
Play it.
Play the drop. Play the drop, please, Emma. Emma, hit him.
Do it up. Not gooey enough. Do it up. I need more goo.
You know, I don't make those, by the way, just to be clear.
No, I know.
Dear Dofam, enjoy this kiss-related drop from the 300th episode. Thanks for the laughs. Not sarcastic. With love, Dan Padley. Twitter, Padley Dan. Thanks, Dan.
That's from back from our 300th episode. We're past the 400 mark now.
We're past 400 now.
That's a dated drop. What is the Kiss song? I don't know it.
I have no idea either. I think Kiss kind of sucks.
Whoa, Padley. Sorry.
Is that wrong? Isn't Gene Simmons in Kiss?
He is in Kiss.
They're fine, I guess.
I honestly don't think I can name a single Kiss song.
Yeah,
Are they Rock and Roll All Night?
They are. Party every day. Yeah.
I think this song might have been Lick It Up by Kiss.
Lick It Up.
Oh, that makes sense.
Kind
they
of fitting
tongues.
For today's episode.
That is fitting. Oh, man. Okay, that's why we chose it. I got a new treadmill. I'm getting a used treadmill. I thought that was a fun discussion to have. Here's the issue. Our guests are funny.
Uh-huh.
They're both very funny. The funniest thing you've said, they say it in a second. It doesn't matter, you know? The funniest thing.
Wait, me specifically?
Yeah.
The funniest thing you said.
Yeah, just, okay, yeah, sure, same. I mean, I'm trickier. But with you, your top 100 funny things you said, these guys could say it in 5 seconds. You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. So it's tricky. I got
you saying that we say it faster? Like we could say it really
in 5 seconds.
I think that you can say it fast and also
we can say the whole movie Naked Gun in 5 seconds.
I ordered a used treadmill for year. That's my big news.
I hope that works out for you. We should also mention while we're in the health domain.
Yeah.
We did a canonical seat swap in our previous episode with Ben Rogers. I'm now seated a camera right. Stage left.
Yes, this is also important.
We used to sit in the opposite places. We recorded a couple of episodes in this format yesterday. Mm-hmm. I came out of it with pretty bad back pain, which I am dealing with today.
You did. Now you see what it was like for me sitting in that chair for so long.
You think it's the chair.
I think it's the chair. Well, there's going to be new, I think, spoiler alert, there's going to be new furniture in here soon.
Hopefully new chairs in the new year. We'll see about that.
Spoiler alert.
The treadmill is at my home. The treadmill will not be in studio.
Uh-huh.
I wish I could have just tuned in and seen that, you know, in the new year.
I'm talking to Soul about getting some sort of like a
Pixar movie.
yeah, I have a lot of issues with that movie, but I'm talking to Soul about getting some sort of Twinkie or donut attachment to the front of the treadmill.
Is that the treadmill brand?
Yeah.
Just thinking about how much faster our guest could have said that than you. Our guest today, the creators...
I'm saying you run, the some sort of food.
I know what you mean. Okay, yeah, right, you'd have like a dangling hot dog, and that'd be a motivator, like a carrot on a stick for a mule. I understood what you were trying to say. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it was good.
Thank you.
I just thought you were saying you wanted to make it twinkier. Because you said I want to get like a twinkier or something, and I was like, did you just want his treadmill to be twinkier?
I do want a twinkier treadmill. Very gray and mechanical. I ate at Safi's last night too. Why? It's a local LA place. I want to say that was very Safi's.
Yeah. Everyone's been talking about Safi's. I got to try Safi's.
Very good.
Our guest today, the creators of the animated series Digman, which is now streaming on Paramount Plus. Andy Samberg and Neil Campbell. Guys, thanks so much for being here. What
Thank
a treat!
Thank you.
A treat for us.
Yeah.
We're very excited to have you here. I was looking at my notes.
What a joyous day.
Joyous day. It is a joyous day. And our last day of school.
Yeah.
This is, I'm flopping all over the place.
You're doing great.
It's like I have a big quiz on the last day
You're
of school. No one
great.
Does that.
We're all shrooming.
We're all having fun.
Yeah. This is blowout last
that's
day.
That's right. Yeah. We did. Oh, we ate chocolate mushrooms.
Yeah. There's not going to be any tests on the last day.
No.
You have to like be there and the teacher kind of checks out.
Yeah. You watch The Sandlot.
Yeah,
in every class. This is college, right?
Yeah. University of Iowa. Yeah.
Unless you got that professor from the new Aaron Payne movie. The holdover. Unless you got the holdovers professor,
right? Giamatti's
Alexander
character.
Payne.
Did I call him Aaron Payne?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my God! Unless you got the holdovers professor. Then you'll probably get an exam on the last day, I'm sure.
You're going to have assignments the whole term.
Yeah.
You're going to have to be running outside in the snow.
Yes.
Is he a tough professor?
He's a tough professor. Yeah. That's kind of what's going on in the movie.
Compared to Snape, where would he be?
Oh, he's
more
stern. Kind of strict.
No, yeah, he's stricter than Snape, I would say.
Wow.
And is Giamatti being strict?
He is, yeah.
Does he ever give points to Slytherin?
No, I don't think he does.
I don't think he does.
I don't think he performs magic, but his eye is, there's something going on with his eye, which I don't know.
They call him Professor Walleye.
They call him Walleye.
Like Mad-Eye Moody.
He's more like Mad-Eye Moody.
I have seen a few movies recently that weren't set in the Harry Potter universe.
Yeah, weird.
Yeah.
Do you think the wonky eye was in the script or an acting choice?
That's a great question.
A lot of actors like to do an eye thing.
I think that the eye does a lot of work in the movie. I think it does some good work in the movie.
I should say Giamatti to me is not someone who leans on a tick.
No.
But it'd be interesting to know.
I can't tell if this eye is CGI. You've seen it.
How does it compare to
I think it was a prosthetic.
How does this role compare to Cleveland Heap?
How does it compare to Cleveland Heap?
His character from Lady in the Water.
Of course.
Oh, yes.
Of course.
We all knew. At any point in the movie, does he go, Cube, we got a test today, Cube. I always imagined you when I sang Cube after that.
That is probably closest to what he does say in the movie. There are very much moments like that.
We have a test.
It's snowing, yes. So we might be like, oh, it looks like an ice cube.
Yeah.
Right.
Right, right. Does he ever say, he's a good kid?
He does.
Giamatti says he's a good kid in a lot of movies.
Yeah.
Win-win.
He does say he's a good kid.
That's my,
Does he ever say, my nanny better not be keeping any diaries.
Oh, nice pull. This guy doesn't even have IMDb open. This is all from the noggin. Did you guys know that Neil knows the best picture winner from every year of the Oscars?
Is that true?
It's probably faded. I used to know it because we would do a lot of quizzes at Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
The guy's like, fucking Rain Man. Ask him any year. Ask him any year.
I wouldn't be so confident anymore.
86.
Platoon.
Wow.
That wasn't even... slow.
Yeah, no.
How about 82? My birth.
Gandhi.
Oh.
Did you guys see what I'm saying? The guy's a fucking, he's a fucking Rain Man.
Let's just stop that while I seem like I know him.
You're true freak.
Yeah, what would you do about it?
Do you have a mind for trivia? Like, can you catalog all those facts, or is it this one specific thing?
I'm pretty decent at trivia.
Because I feel like I, like, know a lot of things, but I'm bad at the skill of trivia, which is its own
thing.
It's
just always, like, category dependent.
Yeah.
Like, there are times where I'm like, I think I could do all right on Jeopardy. Then I watch an episode, and I, column after column, category after category, I'm like, nope. Zero, don't know it, you know.
So. How would you say you do with the pursuit of trivia?
I mean, I find it rather trivial.
That's what I was hoping you were going to say.
Now, Annie and Neil, actually, this happened to you're a California boy.
Mm-hmm.
You grew up in California.
Yeah, in Berkeley.
You exchanged the green of California for the grease of New York City.
Well put.
So when you went over there, was that new for you, living over there for the first time?
Well, I lived there for 2 years in college. I went to NYU for 2 years.
That's right.
And okay. Both my parents are from New York, so we had visited before. So it was, this is a boring, normal answer, but it was not super jarring.
Okay.
Yeah.
Was there big for you? Was there any food changes from
the green of the. From the green to the grease.
From the green to the grease, yes.
A lot of za.
Yeah. Yeah.
A lot of big old floppy slices of za.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What is your like preferred pizza type, and what is your preferred pizza topping or toppings?
Yeah, no, thanks. So I like a thin, like classic.
Yeah.
Like, let me guess, round.
Oh my God. Yes. Yeah. I like a clean pepperoni slice. If you're going to a slice shop,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
If you're going to like a schmancy place, I like, you know, all kinds of stuff.
Did you do DeFara? Did you do any of these spots?
I've had them all delicious.
Yeah.
I mean, in college, I lived on Bleecker. I did a lot of Pizza Box. I did a lot of Bleecker Street Pizza.
John's of Bleecker? Did you do?
Oh, yeah. John's of Bleecker. But that's a sit down, get a full pie kind of a sitch.
Yeah. I've never had it still. It's on my list. I have a list.
If the wait wasn't so long, I don't know what it's like now. When I was in college, it was like a huge deal to get a table there. Yeah. Because it was all. That but and then one time I went and I was like, yeah, it's really good.
Wow. Lucali is also another you gotta wait outside and it takes like two hours or something to get a seat. But
have you been there?
No, I'm
just listing pizza places you haven't been to.
I mean,
there's a few I list they're on my list to go to. John's of Bleecker and Lucali are on there.
I bet you can just walk right in now.
Yeah, I wonder. Yeah, I think they're still pretty popular. I went on a pizza tour with some of my Quincy friends, and we went to and Titano's was closed down near Coney Island, I guess. Mm-hmm. And then and we didn't get to the other ones, but it's on my go to list. But what's your favorite? Oh God,
give me.
I actually have a funny DeFara story.
This is one of the older great pizza spots.
Brooklyn one, right?
Yeah, out there.
And it's one chef and no one else was allowed to touch the pizzas.
Yeah, it's an old man.
I think I'm thinking of the right name.
Yeah.
And I wanted to go so bad. My sister lived with her husband, in Jersey at the time, and I was in the city. And I convinced them to come pick me up because they had a car and drive me all the way out there. And there was so much traffic, but they did it. And we went, ordered. It was the guy, he was there. He's the legend guy. We're like, holy shit, we're doing it. They gave us the full pie. It took forever to cook because they made it from scratch right in front of us. It was like 40 minutes.
Yeah.
Handed it to us, went, sat down. I picked up the Parmesan to just do a little Parmesan, and the lid was loose.
Oh, my God.
And I dumped the whole fucking jar of Parmesan on it. We went, no! And like started like scooping it up with napkins and shit. And it melted immediately because it had just come out of the oven. And it honestly probably like 2.5 to 3 hours leading up to that moment
just to have the pizza.
And then we like ate it and it was way too salty and cheesy.
What a nightmare.
And we were all trying to pretend like it was okay. It was like, you can tell what it's supposed to taste like. No. I bet it would have been really good.
Did the old man react to this at all? Was he upset or?
I don't think he noticed. I'm pretty sure he couldn't
see. Actually a relief.
Yeah. He probably would have said like Madone or Mamma Mia or something.
Yeah, that's probably.
Yeah. Maybe even I Caramba. That's just something
he might have said I Caramba.
I'm projecting. I don't know why
he would
say it.
Simpsons big at that point? I can't tell if.
Simpsons? I mean, have they ever stopped?
That's
don't answer that.
Andy, I wanted to ask you about something, which was, and you know, we were talking about joyous days earlier. We were all in attendance of one joyous day. Our mutual friend David Phillips, you officiated his wedding.
That's right.
It was a lovely ceremony.
Yeah.
And a couple of things of note happened that we've talked about on the podcast involving me and Mitch that I don't know if you've heard about.
I don't think I have.
The first is an older guest at the at the wedding was looking at me and like was like kind of like pointing at me a few times and looking at me, and the photographer came up to me and said, he asked if you were Johnny Depp. But the other thing is,
But wait, like old Depp or present Depp?
Either way, it was like it's
crazy either way.
Your wedding attire is not like really a lot of scarves and bracelets.
Right, yeah.
They were like, no, he's Keith Richards.
Either way, he is 20 years older than me, so not like particularly flat.
Yeah, you don't love here.
No, anymore. But the other thing is, so Mitch.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so here's what happened. Mitch comes up to me and he says,
"Oh yeah, oh no,"
because we're at this rural area, and you know there's a miniature horse on this property. There's a pony on this property.
Oh, I know that pony.
Mitch comes up to me and he says, "The hosts here, the parents of the bride yelled at me," which I immediately believe. I'm like, "Okay, yeah, of course, Mitch got in trouble or something." Yeah. I was like, "Oh, what happened?" And Mitch goes,
I said that.
The horse is named Rodeo.
It only had one eye, right?
Yeah, it had one eye.
I'm not going to say it.
So Mitch says, they caught me sucking off Rodeo.
What?
Wait.
I just want to be clear. I did not suck Rodeo off.
Right. You didn't. Uh-huh. But so why'd they think that, though?
They got mad at me. I think I was looking at the eye, and I think I got a close look at the eye. And then they came up and yelled at me. They said, don't suck off Rodeo. I said, I wasn't sucking them off.
They did not say that.
No, this is a complete lie. It's a complete fabrication. It's a fabrication that he was filleting this miniature horse. I of course, I believe it at first, and he sells it really well, and I laugh a lot when he tells me the lie. And then I watch him go and do the same thing to Neil.
He might not have been able to. I think you might have been laughing through the like. I got in trouble. Time. Yeah. it was never believable.
Well, fun fact, my daughter has ridden Rodeo
and
loves Rodeo. So next time she brings Rodeo up, I'm definitely going to tell her that story. You know, I know a guy who got caught sucking Rodeo off. But he didn't really. He was just saying that to bust his friend's balls.
That's my version of busting friend's balls.
Yeah.
Saying I sucked a pony.
Hey, you know that pony your daughter rode on?
Yeah. I sucked it.
It's got one eye, the Rodeo, which is a beautiful little animal.
Beautiful.
Oh, don't walk it back.
I think we did make jokes that I snuck up on the side where Rodeo didn't have an eye to suck it off.
Naturally, yeah.
Sure, no peripheral.
There was stuff like that, too.
Horses, you know, they'll kick if you try to suck them off, unless they've got one bum eye.
Had you officiated a wedding before?
No, I had never officiated one. I've done a lot of like toasts and speeches and stuff. But
that seems particularly stressful. I've never been in that position myself.
It was a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
You don't want to be like, I knew they wanted me to be funny, but you also don't want to be so much trying to be funny that all the adults are bummed out.
Right.
Yeah.
Because they're like, it's our children and, you know.
Of course. Yeah, yeah.
Family, friends.
It was very funny and very sweet. I thought it was very... Yes.
Phillips and both of their vows were so great, but he had a moment in his, I mean, it's very personal, but fuck it, where his voice cracked because he got so emotional.
Yeah.
And it was right on her name. And it was, I laughed so hard. I was like, I'm trying to officiate and be like, you know, stoic enough.
Yeah.
And he was just like, the whole place just fell apart. They're dying laughing. And you're just like, I mean, it's funny, but also nice. It was like from a movie. It was like,
it was beautiful. It was a great day.
Super fun, beautiful day. Many of the guests bought hats at the hat store in town.
We were part of the hat crew.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which was, I mean, joyous, I think is the right word.
Yeah. It was another joyous day.
I missed the haberdashery, but I know that Susser was there. Susser tried on a hat and was thinking of getting it, and second guesses, like, I couldn't pull this off.
And then,
puts it down, and then Carl Tart comes up, picks it up, and says, I'm getting it, and just puts it on.
Carl was sort of the guy who pushed the hat day and made it a thing.
Carl looked good.
The hat spot. Yeah.
Yeah, Carl was great in that hat, and Susser did look good in the hat. We were telling him to get it. He could have, but he blew it. He blew it pretty bad.
And I mean, it was like a cowboy hat, right?
Yeah, it was a cowboy hat. Carl looked cool as hell.
Yeah.
Carl was rocking it. I don't think I would have showed up to that wedding in a cowboy hat personally.
No. But did I get a hat?
Yeah. I can't remember. I think you did.
I know you did. Yeah.
Did you have a newsboy hat? What did you have?
I don't know.
You and me in those hats popped up on my iPhoto photo of the day.
I got a Scally cap. Yeah, that's what I did. Yeah, it was nice.
Yeah, you should wear that hat in studio. That'd be fun.
Yeah. I look kind of like an Irish asshole when I wear it a little bit.
Oh, yeah. You don't look like that now.
I don't think people's assholes look different based on that.
I have another question here.
Okay, great.
Well,
Neil, should we go?
I think it's hard.
Mitchie's reading up his phone.
They already talked about the show.
sorry.
Ate at Safdie's last night. I already said that.
Yes.
Safdie's, sorry.
Safdie's, though? Safdie's?
I don't know.
Safdie's are the directors.
That's right.
They don't run that.
Action Cut, all the rest.
Yes, that's correct.
Which Safdie's your fave?
Man, that's hard to pick.
Benny or Josh? Which of the Safdies?
I'm gonna go with Josh just because I feel like Benny is getting more of the juice right now. He's more in the spotlight. Yeah. So I'm like, I'll go with Josh.
Yeah, more of a director guy. I mean, I know they both directed, but it seems like Josh is gonna do the next one. But hey,
Benny's good too,
Benny. What can I say?
Yeah. Okay, great.
How good is he in Are You There, God? Performance.
He is really good in Are You There, God? Yeah. It's Me, Margaret. Yeah. He does a good job.
Yeah.
I like them both equal. I know that's not really fair, but I like them both.
Oh, I wasn't going to answer that question. I thought it'd be funny to ask.
Neil, you wrote and produced Brooklyn Nine-Nine. You were the star of Brooklyn Nine-Nine. Mm. I did an episode of it.
That's right.
It was a blast. People went bonkers over it, I believe.
Kyle Murphy, is that your character?
Kyle Murphy is my character. I rapped at the end of the episode.
Yeah, you did.
But I just wanted to admit something to you is that you're a Pink Floyd fan.
Yeah.
And you were talking to me about The Final Cut.
Uh-huh.
And The Final Cut is one of my favorite albums. I think I maybe did tell you this already, but you were talking about The Final Cut, and I was like, "He's like, you have The Final Cut?" I was like, "Yeah." And you were like, "You like it?" I was like, "Oh, I love it." And I thought you were talking about the computer program, The Final Cut. And then
the Macintosh editing suite.
I realized afterwards. Oh, Pink Floyd! I love Pink Floyd.
Yeah,
but I want to admit that to you. It's something that I kind of held in ever since that
day.
Yeah,
it would have been great if you had told me then too. But yeah, no.
Yeah.
Respect. I just love thinking about you being like, "Why is he asking me that?"
What's your favorite track? Video 2.
I just like that would be what I would make conversation about.
Yeah, no,
what
I was...
What about Word?
I think I was nervous a little bit about it, and I didn't want to correct it, but I love The Final... I'm a huge, huge, huge Final Cut fan.
I feel like usually when I bring that album up to people, they're like, no.
Oh, no, that's, it's become, as I've gotten older, I think my favorite Pink Floyd fan.
Why is it polarizing?
Roger Waters kind of took over, also a polarizing figure in general,
sure,
but he took over the band kind of at that point, and it was just kind of his. It was almost a solo album, right? It was after the
wall. And so no matter what, like him being like, now I'm officially in charge after the wall, which everyone was like, they just did it.
Yeah.
Like the wall, which was after, I mean, that was like four or five in a row incredible records.
Yeah. And I love the wall is probably my favorite album, but still a mix of Gilmore and the band is still kind of working together.
Dark Side, I don't know if this is the right order, Wish You Were Here, Animals, The Wall.
Yes.
Those were four in a row in some order.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then Final Cut,
yeah.
And you're like, well, it's not as good as those.
It's not, but now it's become, it's just very much like a Roger Waters solo album. And then those guys are like kind of just filling in.
That's the one that ends with Two Suns on the Sunset.
Yeah,
right?
which is about a nuke
dropping.
Yeah.
It's
great.
It's pretty haunting.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I went so deep into Pink Floyd in high school that I like listened to like Radio Chaos and Pros and Cons of Hitchhiking and stuff.
Oh, me too. Yeah.
I would try and play that shit with my friends and they'd be like, what are you doing?
Yeah. It was like, Jim Ladd did like the, you know, Jim Ladd, who was like an LA DJ. He did like basically like he would play music and then he would just kind of like play whatever next track came to him. I guess DJs do that anyways. Hmm. But
it seems to be exactly what I think they do.
But he's a famous. Tom Petty wrote the last DJ about this guy, about Jim Ladd. Those albums, some of the Roger Waters solo albums. Certainly.
I thought it was about DJ from Roseanne.
The last DJ.
Yeah.
I didn't think that, but now I do.
Yeah.
It might still be. I'm not sure.
From the series finale when he's showing his mom his editing suite.
Is that really what happens to the?
I think so.
God damn! He's like a fucking Rain Man. 1992, Best Picture.
Unforgiven.
Wow.
Wait. Yeah. That's right.
Wow. That was that early?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Unforgiven is a good movie.
I gotta throw a hard one at you.
Gene Hackman. How great is he?
Yeah, he's good.
Love him in anything.
He's still going. He's
straight up retired.
Yeah.
Mooseport and then riding his electric bike around.
There was a photo of him at a Wendy's.
Oh, it was Wendy's. I thought it was McDonald's. Wendy's.
He was like crushing a chicken sandwich outside of a Wendy's in New Mexico.
I like a Wendy's, all right.
Yeah, me too.
Well, okay. So we should get into some of that too. So,
I mean, it's low on my list if we're talking about like a drive-through fast food.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
But I still will eat it.
Wait,
does that make sense?
What are
100%. Yeah. What are
your top tier choices?
Yes. We're going to have the same thing.
I mean, growing up, the ones I went to the most were Jack in the Box and Taco Bell.
Wow. I did do a lot of Jack in the Box.
A lot of
I'm
Jack
also
in
from
Box.
California.
A lot of the like chicken strips, chicken fajita pita, two tacos for 99 cents.
Yes.
Curly fries.
Yeah.
That was a standard.
You head to New York, from the green to the grease. Jack in the Box is gone.
That's true.
Jack in the Box is no longer there.
Yeah, I thought it was national until later in life.
That's right. Yeah.
What do you do then? What becomes your go-to?
We would go to Taco Bell.
Yeah.
Taco Bell, though, there was a Taco Bell near where we lived on 6th Avenue, and we'd go there a lot. And then one night we were out drunk, and we were walking home, and like as a bit, we like went to the closed Taco Bell window to be like, be open, you know, and we just saw fucking rats everywhere inside. And we were just like, oh, no, like we can't ever go back. They were like on the counter.
Oh,
it was so burly.
Oh, that fucking sucks.
Yeah, it gives me the creeping willies even now thinking about it.
This is it's sad that we'll probably go to New York and review that Taco Bell for a future episode.
I mean, in the daytime, it tasted A-okay.
It could have been like the end of Ratatouille.
That's true.
Yeah, they might have been cooking.
Yeah.
Gets
the whole family there.
Neela, dude, remind us.
It's like a test kitchen.
Remind us some of your favorite fast food joints from growing up.
Let's see.
Because you lived everywhere. That was part of your childhood.
Yeah,
What was your favorite one in Japan?
Let's see. There were a few on the army base I lived on in Japan. That was like Anthony's Pizza, I think it was called.
Okay.
Camp Zama. And then if we went to Atsugi for like a soccer game, they had a McDonald's and that was exciting.
That's fun.
Did they have any items there that they don't have here?
Not that I recall, but I don't know that I had the knowledge to know that. And also when they were on an army base, they were sort of the Americanized or a military base.
Why did you be like, you know, the standard stuff, deep fried sushi.
We did go to, we go off the base a lot, but I don't know that we'd hit like chains off base. I know KFC was like really big in Japan.
Yes, I've heard of those.
But yeah, growing up, I don't know. Popeyes we liked a lot when I was a kid. They had those
Popeyes.
In Virginia.
Okay.
Yeah, Popeyes. And I actually wasn't big into McDonald's, but. Although one time I do remember really rushing to get through McDonald's so that we could get home in time for Alf.
Oh, you gotta make Alf.
Yeah.
Got him.
I feel like if you didn't spend all your time memorizing these Siller.
Damn, he nailed it.
And he floated away.
If you didn't spend your time memorizing all these silly Oscar picture winners, you'd remember more about this McDonald's in Japan.
That's true. That's why they pushed it out. Wow, they pushed it out. Yeah. No, it was on Atsugi, where I think Lee Harvey Oswald was stationed.
Wow. I didn't realize he was stationed.
Did you guys hook up? Now, Neil, does that mean you're a military brat?
Sort of. I mean,
he's a brat. I'll tell you that much.
He's more of a military well-behaved.
Yeah. I mean, my dad was mostly at the Pentagon, so we're mostly Northern Virginia, but lived in a few places, and then they moved to Heidelberg when I was in college. So,
so you were just like running around the Pentagon, like chasing a ball on a stick.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah. He got loose from the daycare.
Rolling the little hula hoop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was ice cream big in Japan? This is a pretty good segue.
This is a great segue.
Was ice cream big in Japan?
Yeah. I don't recall having a period in my life where ice cream was not a treat that people enjoyed.
It's been pretty popular for a while now.
Yeah, yeah. But I don't recall if there were like parlors, Japan specific ones at the time.
So salt and straw, two things.
Why are you trying to do this?
Because he's red hot.
He's sitting in that chair now.
It's like, just keep feeding the beast, man. He keeps dropping trays.
We'll take a break. We'll be right back. Hey, buddy, if you're like me, you like being awake, but you like being asleep even more. Well, if you want to catch some Z's, check out the Helix mattress. The Helix lineup offers 20 unique mattresses, including the award-winning Lux Collection, the newly released Helix Elite Collection, a mattress designed for big and tall sleepers, and even a mattress made just for kids. So how will you know which Helix mattress works best for you and your body? Take the Helix Sleep Quiz and find your perfect mattress in under 2 minutes. Wow. And your personalized mattress is shipped straight to your door, free of charge. Helix knows there's no better way to test out a new mattress than by sleeping on it in your own home. That's why they offer a 100-night trial and a 10 to 15-year warranty to try out your new Helix mattress. Everybody is unique, and everyone sleeps differently. That's why Helix has several different mattress models to choose from, each designed for specific sleep positions and feel preferences. Models with memory foam layers to provide optimal pressure relief if you sleep on your side. Models with more responsive foam to cradle your body for essential support in stomach and back sleeping positions. Plus, enhanced cooling features to keep you from overheating at night. And if your spine needs some extra TLC, they got ya. Every Helix mattress has a hybrid design, combining individually wrapped steel coils in the base with premium foam layers on top. Wow, it's the perfect combination of comfort and support. Me, I took the Helix Sleep Quiz. Yeah, even I did. And I was matched with a Moonlight Lux mattress because I wanted something that felt soft. This mattress is a huge upgrade from my old one. Not only is the best mattress I have ever slept on, but the setup was fast and easy. Helix mattresses are delivered in a box and straight to your door for free. Plus, Helix mattresses are American-made and come with a 10 or 15-year warranty, depending on the model. Don't want to take my word for it? Helix has been awarded the number one mattress picked by GQ and Wired magazine. It is even recommended by multiple leading chiropractors and doctors of sleep medicine as a go-to solution for improving your sleep. Helix is offering 25% off all mattress orders and two free pillows for our listeners in honor of Black Friday. Go to helixsleep.com/doughboys and use code HELIXPARTNER25. This is their best offer yet, and it won't last long. With Helix, better sleep starts now. We've all been there. Racing to multiple stores. Spending way too much time scanning shelves for the perfect present, only to settle on another gift card for mom. It's almost like a tradition at this point. Sad, isn't it? Well, here's a gift idea that could make your mom really happy this year. And we'd love to make your mom happy this year. A digital picture frame, Aura Frames, loaded with all of her favorite pics. Wirecutter called it the best digital photo frame. Me, I'm really looking forward to sharing pictures of me and us, the family, and memories and travel and all that great stuff with my mom and with my parents. Because you know what? It's the sort of thing that happens in adulthood is at a certain point you're like, what do I get? What do I get anyone anymore? People have stuff. They have their own hobbies. They have plenty of possessions. What they really need and really want is some quality time with their loved ones. And that's a thing that you get from Aura Frames. The best part, this is a gift that keeps on giving. It has unlimited storage so you and the rest of the family can upload as many pics to the frame as you want year round. All you need is the free Aura app. Give your mom the most thoughtful gift ever this year. Give the perfect gift this holiday by visiting AuraFrames.com today and get $30 off their best-selling frames with the code DOUGHBOYS. These frames sell out quickly, though, so get yours before they're gone. That's AuraFrames.com with the promo code DOUGHBOYS. Terms and conditions apply. Welcome back to Doughboys. We're here with Andy Samberg and Neil Campbell of Digman, which is now streaming on Paramount Plus, talking about Salt and Straw. Nice little high five there. That was great. Yeah.
Proud of our show.
Yeah.
Very funny show. People should check it out.
Thanks.
So Salt and Straw was founded in Portland, Oregon in 2011. There are 36 locations. Investors include Danny Meyer from Shake Shack, Mitch.
Yes.
And also Dwayne The Rock Johnson, which we'll talk about.
Wait, Dwayne?
He is an investor in the franchise, which is partly why he has an investor tie-in. Yeah.
That explains something that we're going to talk about
in
a bit.
Okay. I'm going to say this. Salt and Straw, not the first things you think about when you think about ice cream.
Mitch, those were the raw components they would use to make their test batches in a garage back in the day.
Well, color me corrected. So
it's not a straw that you drink through.
No, it's like actual straw that we'd use to pack in the frozen batches, apparently.
Of course.
Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah.
So but they are. They're opening it. Opening. They're packing things. They've just seen The Artist in theaters.
Oh, okay.
We got to open our, it's 2011. We got to open our first store.
Yes. Yeah.
Right.
Did The Artist go on to win Best Picture?
Oh, yeah, I guess it did.
In 2011?
Well, yeah, I mean, the Oscars took place in 2012, but for, yes, the year 2011.
The guy's like a freaking...
Wait, what year did Rain Man win Best Picture?
88.
Wow.
It won Best Picture.
It
I didn't
did.
Even realize that.
Yeah.
Oh.
Snake eating its tail.
So one of the things Salt and Straw is known for, if people aren't familiar with it, is that it has like, you know, it's like an upscale parlor. There's a lot of these concepts these days, but it also has outlandish seasonal flavors that oftentimes include unconventional savory components, some of which we touched on today. But just to give a couple of examples from year round, one, they have the Don Buggito's Creepy Crawly Critters, which is an ongoing flavor every year. Toffee brittle mealworms and chocolate covered crickets tossed in a matcha ice cream.
Sounds like that Taco Bell.
Bugs are like rats.
Similar vermin. They also have so I go to the one in Culver City with some frequency, and they had an elote asado flavor over the summer. It was made with corn, mayonnaise, and cotija.
Ooh.
And I asked one of the employees about it, and she said it tasted like frozen puke. So like they do take big swings, and sometimes they absolutely don't work, but they sell it anyway.
Can you give her name so we can have her fired from.
It sounds to me like there's like a kind of like the jelly beans in the Harry Potter jelly
beans,
right?
Yeah.
Where there's like a component of like, I dare you.
100%. No, that absolutely is a thing they're leaning into.
Which in the holdovers, he does have those jelly beans.
Oh, see? Okay. So it is in the Harry Potter
universe. I think it is the Harry Potter universe.
He has Birdie Butts.
Mitch, have you had much salt and straw in the past?
I have had salt and straw on its own.
Okay.
It just says yes.
Don't look at my script.
Mitch was looking at his phone.
I was not looking at my phone.
Yeah.
I was not. I've had.
I'm just giving context for our audio listeners.
I've had salt before.
Yeah.
And I haven't. I've our old friend Rodeo, I've seen eat straw.
Right. But you were sucking his dick. You're like, that's a lot of straw. That was you. The thing you wanted people to think. On the pony my daughter rides. Fine, I was like sweating the wedding and make a special.
I have not had the restaurant Salt and Straw.
So this was your first time having it.
Suck Rodeo's dick. Just to be clear,
last
time.
Oh, yeah,
we know.
Tempted.
Oh, yeah, it's a beautiful Schwanz. That's what you were going to say, right? In that exact way?
I just wonder how, like, Phillips would react if I did suck Rodeo's dick. We don't have to think about it now. This is very funny.
It would be hard
for
him.
That's the only thing stopping you is worrying about his reaction.
I think it'd be difficult for him to suss out because he'd be like, that's objectively funny, but it is my wedding.
Yes, yeah. And I guess that is, I guess if you want to say, if I think you could classify that under making a scene at the wedding would be, is sucking Rodeo's dick would be making a scene.
I mean, as long as no one saw it and it wasn't during the ceremony.
That's a good point, too.
Yeah.
There were options.
It's like a fun little later on kind of nugget to drop out on.
Sure.
Your wedding was so beautiful. Oh, there's something I've always wanted to tell you. You know the horse that was at your wedding?
Rodeo?
Yeah, I remember Rodeo was smiling so big the whole wedding. I guess he, because of our love.
Oh, anything else? Do you remember anything else? It's just he seemed really content. Like,
Rodeo, great animal, beautiful animal. Salt and Straw, I haven't had it too often. I told.
Wait, so you have had it?
I have had it.
Okay.
I've been to Jenny's. I've had quite a bit. Salt and Straw I had like way back in the day, and I was like, I don't know about this, but I have to tell, and I know that this is gonna sway me a little bit, but during the strike, I was in a show called Twisted Metal with Stephanie Beatrice is in, and she's great. She's the coolest. And she did the show.
Yeah, she's the best.
And
Neil knows her too because of Brooklyn.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You guys both know her.
And I know her because of Doughboys. Oh,
and now Nick knows her too.
Did she do this?
She did do this. Yeah.
Was she cool?
She was
the coolest.
Oh, thank God, because I just fully vouched for her on the record.
You guys can commiserate about being on the show after this.
Can't wait. As soon as I leave, I'm going to hit her on the car phone. Steph! Oh, we're Doughboys bros! Where are you? I'm coming over.
She was, like most guests, probably baffled by the show, as you probably are too.
Oh.
Well, it's bad in many ways. So the Twisted Metal, they did a thing where they had sweet tooth ice cream.
That's right. This was a limited flavor that you were not able to talk about because of the SAG AFTRA strike.
At Salt and Straw, right, Jen?
At Salt and Straw, they actually were serving out of sweet tooth ice cream truck, which is as terrifying
as you were in the show.
Which I was in the show. For me, it's not that scary. For human
beings,
to
you, it's just like another prop.
For me, yeah. I guess. Oh yeah, in a prop, and also for my character Stu. I won't get into it too
much. Like Harrison Ford sees the Millennium Falcon at Disneyland. He's like, who fucking cares?
Yeah.
We're like,
you know what I mean?
That's like seeing a car or a bus to him, I'm sure, in many ways.
It's like seeing like a broken down shitty bus. That's how it is for you to see Sweet Tooth's ice cream truck.
It was a very hot mail truck was what it was.
That's right.
But which we've all seen.
You're saying the picture car was constructed from a mail truck.
Mail truck, yes. Yeah. So,
do trucks have gender up top? Please don't laugh that long.
So there was a sweet tooth ice cream, and I said, I gotta try the sweet tooth ice cream.
Mm-hmm.
But I couldn't get it. It was at Comic-Con. So I slid into
Sweet Tooth's DMs.
I slid into Salt and Straw's DMs, which is just as kind of sad.
It was a DM slide.
It was a DM slide. Yeah. I said, can I try this? I'm going down to San Diego. We went down for a live show with our guest here.
That's right. Neil was with us.
And
was Fran Gillespie.
And Fran, funny show. We blew the roof off the place, as they say.
Neil, congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah, it was knocked out of the park. They said, sure, stop by this location on the way back. And I stopped by and they gave me some of the sweet tooth ice cream. So, and I loved it.
What was it?
It was like kind of like cake and funfetti. It was great.
Kind of like a birthday flavor.
Kind of colors.
It was. Yeah. It was great.
That sounds good.
And I loved it. And they were very nice to give. So I now do like Salt and Straw quite a bit.
You have some affection for it naturally.
I think that they do a lot of strange flavors.
They absolutely do. Yeah, that's a big thing. Neil, Salt and Straw. Have you had it before?
Yeah, I have it. I don't get ice cream a whole lot, but I'd say Salt and Straw, Van Leeuwen, and Jenny's are all kind of in the rotation, and I live very close to the one that's right next to where we are right now.
Wow.
And I've kind of become a bit of a, I like to try the weird flavors that at these places and don't just stick with the usuals. So I've drunk the Kool-Aid about like these sort of fancier ice cream places.
Right. And Andy, you were saying you're something of a Salt and Straw regular. Is that correct?
I eat a lot of Salt and Straw.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
They have two that I get every year. One is the Halloween Candy Copia, which I fucking love.
Great flavor.
It's next door to our studio, and I saw that to the HeadGum studio, and I saw that ice cream flavor, and I never got it, and I'm sad.
It's bomb.
I got it this year, and it was really good.
And then the other one I love that Phillips also loves, David Phillips, but my wife does not like, is the Lucky Charms one, the St. Patrick's Day one.
Yeah.
Where it's like, you know, cereal milk ice cream with all the like marshmallows in it.
Yeah.
And that's the like nostalgia highbrow trash food thing that I always go for.
Yeah.
The Candycopia, I just looked it up real quick, and it's like a sweet cream with Kit Kats, Reese's, Snickers, Heath Bar. Yeah. Just like all the candies are there. Everyone is here.
In around April, one of my favorite things, they have like they do rodeo dick flavored ice cream.
And that's in April. Why April?
I think it's like to like I think
taxes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right, sure, yeah.
You can write, you know, like oftentimes I write off a trip to visit rodeo.
And it's specifically more of a dick flavor, not a cum flavor, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, got it. Oh. Yeah.
Well, because you get interrupted by those nosy neighbors.
Those nosy neighbors.
Who own the horse.
I got to tell you, rodeo is not easy to make finish.
Right. You think it's rodeo is the problem, or?
It might be me.
Yeah. Like, how do you do with your other horses?
No issue with them, usually.
Okay.
Yeah, fast draw Munnings, you're able to.
I also do Salt and Straw fairly regularly. There is one it's a long walk, but I feel like a long walk earns me a scoop of ice cream, and I love ice cream. It's my favorite dessert, and I just can't keep it in my freezer because I just will eat all of it. So I have to make it a special occasion. It's a nice place to take a long walk towards and reward myself with a cone. So we should talk about this particular Salt and Straw because there is some controversy involving the location that's on the same block as the HeadGum Studios here in Silver Lake. It's right next to a local spot called Pozzo Gelato, Mitch, that has been around for 17 years. Mm-hmm. And Pozzo Gelato is now being evicted. And there's speculation that it's because Salt and Straw, which is this larger corporation, you know, with the Shake Shack investor and The Rock, that they have a non-compete clause in their lease that is causing this, you know, longtime institution to have to leave the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wait, the gelato place has to
Gelato
leave?
Place is going to be leaving, yeah.
Because a new place has a non-compete?
That's the speculation, but there's no evidence. This is just like people are kind of, kind of assuming that's what's going on because two ice cream parlors and literally steps away doesn't make a whole lot of sense.
Isn't there another one? Isn't like Moshti Malone's?
That one's not far either, yeah. Anyway, so Anya, I was talking to Anya from HeadGum here earlier, and she said her take was Salt and Straw is so good that it makes her abandon her morals. She was like, I don't even care about eating local, like supporting local businesses. This is so good that I don't have any principle there. Which is a take.
Interesting.
Maybe it's HeadGum that's evicting them. If Anya's saying this, possibility.
That would be quite the twist. Can you fucking believe Salt and Straw is doing that? Oh, it's us.
Yes, there's a lot of there is some controversy around this.
Involving
it's a
this
bummer,
specific one.
I guess. Yeah.
It is a little bit. And you know what, and again,
it's crazy that the Rock is going to rock bottom them if they don't leave. I've heard too.
Really nicely. Yeah. I don't see the logic there. Like,
yeah.
If you were on Main Street in Disneyland, I'm bringing up Disneyland again, and there were like two different kinds of ice creams a few doors from each other, you'd be like, yeah, it's...
Yeah, exactly.
Sometimes
yeah,
I want one, sometimes
gelato
I want the other.
Ones,
yeah. Right, it's a different thing.
Yeah.
And that one's got coffee. It feels like the concepts could coexist.
Also, gelato is like so much more gelatinous, you know?
Mm, that's true.
I agree.
Great point.
Is that true?
I pray so. Okay.
Okay, so this is, and you know, Van Leeuwen was mentioned, Jenny's was mentioned. So this is like the artisan, ice cream sector is getting kind of crowded right now.
Yeah.
We went over, Amelia and I went in advance and got the, got one of every flavor. I want to shout out Maddie and Noah from the Silver Lake Salt and Straw because they were absolute champs. We knew we were being annoying. We apologized and they scooped everything and labeled it
and
for us.
And when you guys
so
went over there,
we could taste it all.
It was quite an adventure. Play the clip.
Wait
a minute.
Do we get their like security?
Hey, Nick, here we are.
Hey, I'm Noah.
Thanks,
man, these cream. Guys again. All right, how many flavors?
All of them.
Yeah. No, it's just my normal speaking voice.
All right, we're back. Digman now streaming on Paramount Plus. Check that out. They were
just
great.
I just want to also be clear that we talked about all the rodeo stuff.
Uh-huh.
I'm not like, I can go to Churchill Downs and stuff like that. I'm not like, I just want
to say I can go to church still.
I can still go to church. In fact, I'm go more often after I see rodeo.
I feel like the day this episode comes out will live in infamy.
Oh, God. This guy's winning it.
This is a release date of what? December 6th?
Digman. December 7th. Digman will be out on December 6th. This episode's coming out on December 7th, Thursday.
I wanted to release it 29 days later, as you know. On January 6th, it was
right.
My
you were like,
Christmas.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
Christmas. Yeah, my Christmas.
Taking it back.
Okay, so I'm going to run through the flavors. So we've got a lot to talk about. So, you know, however we want to tackle this, if anyone wants to talk about their favorites, their picks and pans, but I'm just going to list everything. Sea salt with caramel ribbons, double fold vanilla. You know, I'm a big vanilla guy. Vanilla is a flavor. Chocolate gooey brownie, honey lavender, salted malted chocolate chip cookie dough, olive oil, cinnamon snickerdoodle, strawberry honey balsamic and with black pepper, coffee and love nuts, pear and blue cheese, as well as three vegan flavors, freckled mint chocolate chip, peanut butter brittle caramel fudge, and Marion Berry coconut sherbet.
Can I just say that I was, how do I put this? Pissed off at you.
That's right.
Right. When the day started, I got in here and you had, there was an agenda. Yeah, you can tell the world.
Here's what happened, Mitch. Huh? So we have a tight recording window today.
Yeah.
And so Amelia and I were trying to figure out on a text message thread that you're a part of. We're trying to figure out
I was on it.
We were texting on that thread, the Doughboys thread. Emma is also on that thread. She saw this take place, and I got here early, and so did she. And we're like, you know what? Let's go over. Let's just get a scoop of everything and bring it back to the studio just to save ourselves some time so we can just be ready to go. At the time we are recording, but not at the time this episode will be released, there are some Thanksgiving flavors that exist. And Amelia and I made the executive decision, let's just not get the Thanksgiving flavors because we've already got like 18 things to taste. And there's a Christmas cake, which we'll get to, which we could also have that would be similarly seasonal. So let's just do that.
Yeah. And how did that make me?
You were fucking livid.
Angry.
You were furious. You were
angry.
Yeah, because you wanted the Thanksgiving flavors, and you made Amelia go back and get the Thanksgiving flavors and bring them for you.
What if I had fired Amelia? How would that make you feel?
Yeah,
you
that's a good point.
I mean, it's a point.
Yeah. What if he had done that? I mean,
wouldn't you feel like such an asshole if that had happened?
The plan would have worked fine, except Amelia mentioned the Thanksgiving flavors.
No,
which I
knew about the
Thanksgiving flavors.
And I also knew about them too.
Oh, okay. So that was the issue.
But I was kind of grateful that we weren't going to have them.
Yeah.
But then he freaked out, and then we did have
them. We did get them. I knew once they came up, we were going to get them. So the Thanksgiving flavors are Parker House Rolls with salted buttercream, cheesy potato casserole, turkey stuffing, and cranberry sauce. So those middle two, kind of more the dare flavors.
And I will say that
Mom's mango pie and pumpkin and ginger snap pie, that's a vegan flavor.
Should we start the Thanksgiving flavor?
Yeah, why not?
Yes,
let's start there. On.
Yeah.
The Parker House Rolls with salted buttercream was bomb.
I thought it was great.
I was surprised.
Those
were
really good.
Delicious.
I was surprised. The turkey stuffing and the cheesy potato casserole and even the pumpkin ginger snap pie for me didn't love them.
No,
but
same.
I got the joke.
Well, yeah. It is very much. There's a very strong stuffing flavor in the turkey one. I didn't really taste the turkey that much, but it tastes like stuffing and cranberry.
Yeah.
And then, did you eat any of these or no?
Yeah, I had the pumpkin one, which I always like trying vegan ice creams, but sometimes there's like almost like a crispness in them.
It's like an icy
granular
character to it. Yeah. That's how I felt like that one.
And
came
that one
across,
had that quality that isn't my favorite in a vegan ice cream. I didn't try the. I think the Parker was in the same thing as the turkey, and I didn't want to eat meat, so I didn't want to. I didn't even.
Parker sneaky good, but I think probably because it's salted buttercream is the base.
That's true. Yeah,
yeah.
Which
yeah.
is going to be good almost no matter what. And the roll was sort of
and what
just
was
some
with
texture
the pumpkin
for
one?
The mix.
That one was. I thought that was good.
The
pumpkin and ginger snap pie was the vegan one. The mom's mango pie was the other
mango
one.
Mango was pretty good. Yeah.
You said you revealed something here. Is that you? You're not a huge fan of pumpkin pie.
I'm not a massive pumpkin pie fan, which should be disclosed for anyone out there.
I also am not a huge pumpkin
and
pie.
I do
fan.
Like it.
I like it. Yeah. Yeah. Maybe rather have a sweet potato pie, but I like a pumpkin pie. Yeah,
it's also kind of crazy how pumpkin's a fruit, not a vegetable.
That is kind of crazy.
That is crazy.
Yeah.
That is kind of fucking crazy.
Fuck, it's fucking crazy.
What's the last horror movie to have won Best Picture?
I mean, Silence of the Lambs.
Must have been
I mean, Parasite, right? Do you want to count? Yeah. But Silence of the Lambs is kind of, in a way, the only
Get
one.
Out, shoulda.
Oh, yeah. Hey, there you go.
Yeah.
What was that, 90, what 89? That when year? Was that?
Silence of the Lambs?
Yeah.
91.
91, wow.
What year
okay.
was Get Out? What one?
Because I don't remember what didn't win in a year. I don't know. Also, that's where I actually really fall apart the last 10 years.
Got it. Well,
so if I order a fruit cup, there's a chance they hand me a pumpkin?
It's a possibility, I guess, if someone wants to be really literal about what fruit cup means.
Yeah. No, that fruit actually cup. Could like that could very much happen. You could go somewhere and order a fruit cup. They might just hand you a pumpkin.
It might be all pumpkin, yeah.
Then mark my words, I'll never order fruit again.
And how often do you now?
That's not true. Yeah. Victor, the fruit stand guy, who I get, the best fruit stand.
The JFL
stand
mascot?
Guy. Yeah. Victor from the green goblin from Just for Laughs. He has a fruit stand cart.
Victor is such a perv. We've talked about this before. You just know he's that weird.
He's
like,
French.
Yeah,
I mean,
he's French Canadian.
Ooh, Victor.
My mom was just here. I was having a bit of a how do you put this? A
kiss?
Mental break. Okay, right. Sorry. I found old Just for Laughs stuff, and I found an old Victor toy, and she's like, "You should throw that away." And I did not throw it away. I kept my Victor toy because Victor means a lot to me.
Is
to
it
me,
on display?
What's that?
Is it on display?
It's on display, of course. Wow. To me, he that's what comedy is. He, you look at Victor and you laugh.
Yes.
Oh, God.
Canada's Mickey Mouse.
The Parker House rolls is the only one I would get again, but I did like the Mom's Mango Pie as well. Yep. Of the classics. Okay, so Neil, you were talking about vegan ice cream. I will oftentimes give myself a treat, which is a vegan ice cream from Salt and Straw, even though I am a dairy dude, just because I have like such a gastrointestinal after effect from eating just straight up ice cream. But their vegan ice creams I can get away with, and their freckled mint chocolate chip is like probably my favorite like vegan ice cream flavor.
Yeah,
I think it's great.
That's fantastic.
I couldn't believe it was vegan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really good. It really hits just like mint chip.
And there was another vegan one in there with it, right?
Yes, the Mary and Berry Coconut Sherbet, which is another good one. That one tastes a little bit more vegan-y.
Sherbets aren't my favorite. I never really order one.
I will say, though, the flavor of it was good.
Yeah, totally.
And it got us talking about Mary and Berry.
Yes.
Is it named for Mary and Berry?
No, it's not named for
more
DC
the flip.
Mayor
I think people
Mary
like,
and Berry.
Mayor has a funny name that sounds like a berry you can get. Yeah.
Oh, it's a berry before.
Yeah, it was a berry before the guy.
Spelled slightly differently, yeah.
Okay, fruit. It was another fruit. Another fruit, like pumpkin. We were talking pumpkin as fruit.
That fruit the headless horseman puts on his head.
God damn it.
Yeah, you know what? That takes a lot of the fear of the headless horseman out of it. I'll stand up to him next time I see him.
Peanut butter, brittle, caramel fudge, the third of the vegan flavors. I thought that was also hitting.
Was there a different peanut butter one?
No, that was the only one.
No, that was the only one.
That one was maybe my favorite of all of them.
Yeah,
delightful flavor.
That was very good.
We bookended it with that.
We did.
I liked the you haven't said it yet, the chocolate brownie one.
Yeah,
I did say it.
Oh, well, then you
said it. The chocolate brownie one was bomb as hell.
That was good as hell.
I thought the coffee was really good.
I like their coffee.
Maybe my favorite of the dairy ones.
I'll say this. Some of them, there were two in one cup. And the coffee and the fudge brownie one were kind of mixed together, and it worked.
Yeah. They like complemented each other.
Yeah, they kind of melted together. There's an ice cream thing.
Have you guys ever compliment the guests?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Have we not been doing it enough? You guys are great.
You guys are
doing really good.
You're just fishing?
Yes.
You guys are great. You're being very funny. We're having a good time.
I think you've done great.
You look great. I like your haircut. Do I need to do it too?
No, yeah.
Okay.
We got to call the host.
You guys look great.
We love you guys.
Oh, is that
we're
a new
in love with
Celtics
you.
Hat?
It is. This is a new Celtics hat.
Wow, it makes me want to give you the rodeo treatment.
I think you've crossed out of compliment.
Oh, sorry.
Something else. Yeah.
Neil, I think you're a great friend, and you have great opinions on ice cream. You made me less scared of the Headless Horseman. I think you're a great guy.
Really good qualities.
This couch is nice.
That's going to be your speech at Neil's wedding. Neil made me less scared of the Headless Horseman when he told me that pumpkins are a fruit. I'll never forget that, brother.
And also... he was there when I met my lovely wife, Rodeo.
Yeah, Rodeo's just dead. Rodeo's bronzed now. Doesn't stop me from doing what I do.
All
honey lavender, I get it, but for me, the lavender based ice cream is just not, like, you know, for my palate. I don't love it as much as I know some people do. Strawberry honey balsamic with black pepper. A lot going on here. It was working for some of us.
Going into that one, I was like, I'm not going to like this.
Yes.
And then I did.
Of those were ones where...
fucking rodeo's prawns.
I think it'll never end.
No, yeah.
That was why I thought it was funny. That's why it's a perfect life partner. Anytime you want.
Oh, man.
Both of those, the strawberry and the lavender, fit the category... where I'm glad they give little sample spoons.
Yeah, right.
I don't even want a full scoop of either of those, but I like having one little taste. I go, that's not exactly what I want my dessert meal to be.
I would put the olive oil one in that category too.
Yeah, I actually wanted the olive oil to be a stronger flavor after those. I was like, this feels not as prominent.
Well, we have a big thing to talk about still, Wags.
Yes, that's right. And that
Can I say one more thing?
Please.
I often, when I get salt and straw, get the chocolate chip cookie dough one and love it. It's a very good version of that, and it's kind of a mainstay in my house.
We should have had that one in one of the cups, but maybe it got buried. But that is a good flavor. That is a good go-to flavor, salted malted chocolate chip cookie dough. So, yes, for the season, there is a Christmas collaboration with Dwayne The Rock Johnson for Dwanta Claus, which is The Rock Santa alter ego. Yeah. And we got the Naughty Cake, which is a caramel chocolate and whiskey ice cream cake. We were told it also includes peanuts. It's very chocolatey. The whiskey, you know, is there. I mean, here's the thing. I don't know if I need this thing. Like, I guess you bring it to a party. I guess that's the reason it exists. But it's like, do I need this ice cream cake from this artisan parlor? Wouldn't I rather just have a scoop and a cone?
Does anyone get excited about a Dwayne The Rock Johnson crossover ice cream cake at the holiday party? I don't know if it's flavor.
If it shows up with a big old cake, I guess it's
got a gimmick to it, and it's like, is this from Salt and Straw? I know Salt and Straw. Yeah, okay.
It's really dense, like
very dense. Wasn't,
The flavors were fine to me. It's
had like a 16th of the cake, like a small little like half sliver, and I was like, I do not need any more of this. So
I just want to I just want to say this. Santa Claus is work I book a lot. We were talking about this.
That's right.
And Dwayne The Rock Johnson's coming in and taking a role of Santa Claus. Right. And I think it's an outrage.
And to be clear, the reason you're mad about that is because he's fit, right?
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Okay.
We want to be clear. The reason I'm mad about it is because he's fit.
Right? Okay, got it.
But why the jacked Santa's not fun?
I think it can be fun. Why not? You can have a jacked Santa. You can have a different body type.
Not in red one.
What the hell?
Is that Dwayne's movie where he's Jack Santa?
Is that what it says?
It might be called Redone. I don't know. But...
might be called Redone. Punctuation's unclear.
Yeah, I don't know if I saw a typo when I saw
two tickets to Redone.
Santa's. The role of Santa's made for big, slobby guys.
Oh, wait, red one. 2023.
Red One is the it is the Jake Kasdan movie with Dwayne The Rock Johnson, I guess, as Santa, and Kiernan Shipka also in it. That's fun.
And
J.K. Simmons. J.K. Simmons is Santa. Okay, that's what it is.
Yeah.
Wow.
He was in
J.K. Simmons is ripped as hell.
Yeah. He sure is.
Yeah.
He was in Tomorrow War. I took a picture with him and my mom and my sister.
And he's in Palm Springs.
Oh, right. Oh, my God.
Yeah, that's what I know.
Yeah. I talked to him
We've
once.
Talked about Tomorrow War. I love that movie.
Do you really?
I really do.
Oh,
yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
That makes me happy.
It was a treat seeing you and Sam in there. I was just like,
Oh, yeah. He's great. Sam is great.
The alien swarm sequences in that movie are really good.
They did a great job.
Huh?
The white spikes?
Yeah.
The white spikes.
I'm a big sci-fi person, so when people get alien stuff good action-wise, it makes me very excited.
I thought they did a good job.
Yeah.
And went to the pandemic, put it on Amazon. But
that movie has like six endings, which is incredible.
It goes along a lot longer.
But I was happy about it. I was like, oh, it's still going.
We did a screening of it at our house to sort of celebrate Mitch when it came out. And
I cried when I died.
We all did.
You didn't know it was coming?
Oh, no! Is that what they do with my character?
We shot
to scream loud and then be really quiet.
We shot a post-credit scene with Mitch, and then aired it like on the on the
oh,
screen.
You didn't tell your guests.
We didn't tell the guests. And then after the movie ended, a post-credit scene that we made with Mitch came up.
We should post that. If we could find it, we should post that.
What happens? You come back to life?
Yeah, Colin lived in the end.
Oh my god.
I consider that the canon ending.
Oh, me, it's the only way I watched it.
Any other thoughts on that cake, the naughty cake?
I thought it was fine.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Here's what I'll say, and we talked about this a little before too. The like celebrity crossover food events, I am just kind of a sucker for it. I think it's silly, and I think people get them to be ironic or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I got the offset Hal and Ray's nuggets.
Sure. Yes.
I wasn't thinking about getting Hal and Ray's that day, and then I was like, I love Hal and Ray's. I wonder if the nuggets are super good. And then I got them, and they were like, fine.
Yeah.
Like not as good as their normal stuff, or else they'd probably do nuggets all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But what were you going to say?
You had like an umami burger, right?
Wait, did you really?
I did.
Wow.
During Brooklyn Nine-Nine times, there was a Sam burger at Umami. And it was like,
I can't believe we didn't eat the fucking Sam burger.
Dude, it was good. It was good. And really fun, like figuring out what it was going to be. Cause you do a big call and they're like, what are some of the things you really like that you would want us to try? And I gave them like five ideas, and then me and all my friends went and tried all these different burgers and then like voted.
Oh man.
And the one we ended up doing was a Chicago dog themed burger.
Oh, that's fun.
That rules.
It was so good. I crave it all the time, and I always wish they still had it. And then another one I suggested to them was like a Korean barbecue burger, and now they have one.
That rules.
Like we didn't use it for mine, but they just put it on the menu.
They should call that the Sam Burger or bring back the Sam Burger,
dude,
I say.
Is Umami Burger still happening?
I think they're still around.
I mean, I would beg them to redo the Sam Burger and call it whatever they want. I just want to eat it. It was so delicious.
Bring it back.
Yeah.
Umami's, we talked about it before, a place that expanded very quickly.
Yeah.
That hit some hard times, but then they came back a little bit the last time we were there.
They were on the upswing last time we visited it. At what point in your life did you come to understand that Sam Burger could become Sam Burger? And was there ever a Sam Burger before your collaboration with Umami?
I was called Sam Burger by people like at summer camp and
okay,
stuff.
Okay, sure, yeah.
Also Sam Burglar.
Oh, that's fun.
Mm-hmm. And then it kind of changed to be Sam Bags, which is less good, but... Mm. But, you know, you take what people give you.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was Mitchell or Bitchell. They called me quite a bit.
Bitchell?
Yeah.
Like Billy Bitchell?
Yeah. My dad was Bill Mitchell, but they called me, like Wu-Tang would call me Bitchell.
But they call your dad the Whammer.
They call my dad the Whammer.
So are you talking about the Wu-Tang Clan?
I have a friend named Wu-Tang.
That's right.
Adam Wu.
That's right.
We call him Wu-Tang.
Okay.
And my dad was the Whammer, which sounds like which is a cool sounding name.
Great name.
And he had a pretty big dick as well. So
yeah, the Whammer with a hammer.
Yeah.
It's interesting you say that because I've never heard a dick referred to as a Whammer.
Do you remember passing through his dick when you were conceived?
Yeah, you know what? I was like, a lot of space to get through here. Yeah.
What am I going to be done?
Yeah. Who's the lucky lady?
Oh, it's mommy.
We're going to take one more break. We'll be back with our fork scores right after this. If you take a look at search trends, interest in learning a new language is only increasing over time. And there tends to be a bit of a spike in the fall because it's the perfect time to pick up a new hobby like learning a new language. And with Babbel, you can start speaking a new language in just 3 weeks, just in time to show off at the holidays. This holiday season, you can start speaking a new language with Babbel. Why Babbel? Because it works. Instead of paying hundreds of dollars for a private tutor or fooling yourself with language apps that are little more than games, Babbel's quick 10-minute lessons are designed by over 150 language experts to help you start speaking a new language in as little as 3 weeks. Babbel is designed by real people for real conversations. All of Babbel's tips and tools for learning a new language are approachable, accessible, rooted in real-life situations, and delivered with conversation-based teaching. I've taken some of these courses. They're super convenient. They've helped me learn real-life conversation skills. Makes it so easy to pick up how to order food, ask for directions, speak to merchants without having to consult a language app. Studies from Yale, Michigan State University, and others continue to prove Babbel is better. For instance, one study found that using Babbel for 15 hours is equivalent to a full semester at college. Wow. With over 10 million subscriptions sold, Babbel is real language learning for real conversations. Here's a special limited time deal for our listeners to get you started right now. Get 55% off your Babbel subscription, but only for our listeners at babbel.com/doughboys. Get 55% off at babbel.com/doughboys, spelled BABBEL.com/doughboys. Rules and restrictions may apply.
Our next partner has truly made a positive impact on the most important people in my life. No, I'm not talking about Wags over here. Hey, I love you too, buddy. I'm talking about Wally and Irma.
Let's be real, having a pet is expensive. From natural pet food to pet sitting when you go on vacation, the cost can skyrocket quickly. But one thing that's definitely worth it for your fur baby is pet insurance.
Wags, I love Wally and Irma and want to do everything I can to take care of them.
This podcast is sponsored by Embrace Pet Insurance. It's time to upgrade your pet insurance game. Whether you have a dog or a cat, Embrace Pet Insurance offers customized plans for your pet's exact needs.
Did you know vet care prices have increased by 33% from 2022 to 2023? That's insane, Wags. With Embrace Pet Insurance, you can visit any vet or emergency clinic.
And if you have multiple pets to insure, you are eligible for a 10% multi-pet discount.
Plus, they have a 24/7 helpline and optional wellness rewards program to ensure you prioritize preventative care for your pet, so you hopefully never even need to use Embrace in the first place.
I know some people think pet insurance is too expensive or not needed, but believe me, when facing a huge vet bill and choosing between your budget and your pet's health, you'll wish you had insurance. Embrace is actually very affordable.
Don't wait for the unexpected to happen. Join the massive community of pet owners who trust Embrace Pet Insurance to protect their pet. Head to embracepetinsurance.com/doughboys and sign up for pet insurance today. Make sure you go to embracepetinsurance.com/doughboys or else they won't know that we sent you.
Welcome back. It's time for our fork scores on Salt and Straw. So, Neil, you've done the podcast before. Andy, here's how this will work. We will each go around, give a closing argument, if you will, and end that by giving it a score from 0 to 5 forks. Neil, why don't we start with you? Your thoughts, your fork score.
I can't imagine what they could do better. I thought it was great.
Wow.
You know what? The only thing I would say is I feel like a couple other the ice cream places maybe have a slightly higher percentage of vegan flavors, like one or two more. And I do skew toward those when they're an option.
Yeah.
Try those, especially like when there are seasonal ones, I wish there'd be sort of one or two more, you know, instead of just like one of the seasonal ones being vegan. But, you know, that's just in a dream world. So I'll give it 5 forks.
5 forks!
5 spoons, I guess, in this scenario, right?
It could be spoons. I meant to say, in this scenario, 5 spoons.
Okay, that's fair. Yes. That's good. That makes more sense to me.
How often does something get 5 forks and or spoons?
Probably like very often.
The guests don't ever want to show.
More often than not.
Okay, Neil, though, famously gave Pizza Hut 1 fork.
That's right.
Yeah.
Really?
Back in the day.
Well, I could think of many things that they could improve upon, but in this one, I thought,
Now at both ends of the spectrum, from 1 fork to 5 forks.
Yeah.
Wow. First off, like, why are you being so mean to Lone Star and barf? Is it my turn?
Yeah, your turn.
Okay. This is a tough one for me because I, as I mentioned, am a big Salt and Straw fan.
Yeah.
If I was just getting the ones I love, it would be a no-brainer 5 spoons. However, the gimmicky stuff they do tastes bad to me sometimes, mm-hmm. and even though they are doing it, I think, on purpose in that Harry Potter jelly bean way,
mm-hmm.
it makes it difficult to be like, there's this place that makes edible things, and some of them taste bad to me. So I think I'm going to say, if you know what you're ordering, easy 5 spoons. Definitely some of, if not my favorite ice cream in the LA area. But as someone with like a soul and a conscience, I probably have to say like 4.5.
4.5, still a very good score. Good.
Yeah, wow. But I mean, I really like the stuff there that I like.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, my turn. we were going to do this place for a long time. I also was going to open up the episode with an impression. You remember this. It was going to be Donnie Brasco meets Donnie Darko.
I don't remember this. When did you bring this up?
Why aren't you going to do it now?
Like 6 you should do ago.
It. Because I realized that
it was last time when we were originally going to do this.
Yeah, when we were originally going to do it. And he was like, I gotta go undercover with this rabbit. I don't know, something like that.
And what does that have to do with Salt and Straw?
No,
Okay. So it was just in your head the last time we were going to do this and then had to reschedule.
Donnie
and so you had to bring it up
Donnie
again. Doc got it.
Go. I thought it would be fun to do on this episode and I never brought it up. I'm just saying things.
So you're just like, it's my turn to talk. I'm going to get it out now.
Yeah.
It's your podcast.
I also wanted to say, like, Safdie's 1 verse 2. Like, I had a rhyme for it, of which I was going to choose.
Are you all right?
He seems like not okay.
I'm okay. I promise I'm okay.
Your microphone's falling apart.
Looks like the man upstairs has other ideas.
What's the term for these? The cube that's on the end of the microphone? There's a term for it.
We call them mic flags.
Mitch's mic flag for our audio listeners fell off.
Cube!
Mitch's cube fell off.
Mic flag.
Safdie's 1 verse 2. Which of the two do I most approve? That's what I was going to say.
Perfect.
And I think I go with Benny is my choice, finally.
For sure, worth going back for.
Yeah. Mike Flag could be a nickname for Mitch. He could be Mike Flag, a patriotic version of yourself.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah.
I like that. I'm a Patriots fan. That makes sense.
Yeah.
As opposed to what's the other one again?
Mike Mitchell. Look. Salt and Straw, I'm glad that I got everything I had to say out. Salt and Straw, we've talked about fancy ice cream places. Nancy Pelosi has a lot in her freezer.
She likes Jenny's.
She likes Jenny's.
Yeah. Ooh, that's why the guy was trying to get in.
Yeah, that's why I was there. The reason I was at January 6th is because of Jenny's ice cream. The Salt and Straw, there's some weird flavors, but what they do well, they do very well. And who doesn't like a nice scoop, Wags?
I sure do.
From the man down at the newspaper. God.
Yeah.
You're just trying to name people from different walks of life? Is that what you're trying to do there?
No, I mean like also like a scoop, you know what I'm saying? Like
Woodward and Bernstein.
From Woodward and Bernstein.
Ben Bradley.
Yeah.
Get it.
Who doesn't like a scoop? Is the bottom line.
Certainly the people at Raisin Bran.
That's they like it too.
Yeah.
As long as I could remember, I liked I as far back as I could remember, I liked ice cream. Oh,
Jesus Christ.
He's on fire. The impressions?
When I first ate ice cream just before this.
I think I gotta go with our guests here. I don't know whether to go for 4.5 spoons or 5 spoons.
Go with 4.5 because you basically re-said what I said worse.
4.5 spoons.
All right.
There we go.
We're gonna be ballpark buds here because I'm in the same general area as everyone here. I do like Salt and Straw. A lot of affection for this place. I'm not sure where it ranks versus like a Van Leeuwen or I honestly might like Van Leeuwen a little bit more.
They do Jenny's better vegan. That's
they've got
my
a few more
standard
options
for vegan. But
Jenny's is good. You know, we had a great time at Jenny's. There's a Sweet Rose Creamery, which is more LA focused, but that's another one of these artisan upscale parlors that I like a little bit more than this place. But I do like this a lot. I understand that, again, as we've all said, that the gimmicky flavors are part of their marketing more so than meant to be something that you eat. But you can go very awry by eating that. Here's my question for the panel. Does anyone want to guess how much the Dwanta Naughty Cake, the Dwayne The Rock Johnson Naughty Cake cost?
$20.
Mitch has 20.
35.
Neil has $35.
75 cents.
And he's going low with 75 cents. Would you believe
I stand by it?
That cost $89.
No way.
So this is the thing you have to know about this place. You may encounter some sticker shock.
Man.
That's wild.
Isn't that insane?
And I would love to be in a movie with Dwayne Johnson. But that's a lot.
For just because of its nature and because I know you can go off you can go awry here if you go off the beaten path, and also you're going to spend a little bit more than you will at some other parlors. I think I got to go four forks even for this place, but that still puts it in the Golden Plate Club, Mitch.
You, with the big reveal of the $89 cake, I had no idea. That's crazy.
Isn't that insane?
That is wild. I mean, the offset nuggets were $7,000. I think it was a record label ploy. Like I somehow packaged it.
Andy, you've been in heavy rotation in the commercial breaks of NBA games. You have a Corona, a series of Corona spots, I believe, with Snoop Dogg.
I do.
What was it? Did you have my fellow Long Beach Poly High alum, Snoop Dogg? Did you have? Had you worked with him before? What was that experience like?
We had done a song with Snoop, Lonely
of
Island,
course, yes,
called
yes,
Turtleneck
yes.
and Chain, but we didn't meet him on that. He just sent back the verse, and we were like in heaven. And then he came when we shot the movie Popstar. He showed up and shot a quick cameo in one scene and was super nice. But then when I got asked to do those, the reason I said yes was because it was Snoop.
You right.
know, I just grew up loving Snoop, and everyone says he's great. And they let me and Jake Szymanski write a lot of them. So that was also a reason why I wanted to do it, because I knew we could try and make him funny. But he was super mellow. He loves, like, TV and movies.
Wow.
He really is...
That's great.
He's very laid back energy, but you can tell he really pays attention, and he was referencing all kinds of shit. And when I would suggest jokes and stuff, he'd be like, oh yeah, that's like this, or like, that's like that. He knew all the reference points.
Wow.
Yeah.
Like, could name a best picture winner for like 1987.
Yeah. What's that?
87. Was that The Last Emperor?
Wow.
The guy's a freakazoid.
That's awesome.
My buddy Chankton stood on my shoulders when Snoop played Slope Day at Cornell, and Snoop saw Chankton.
That's cool. Did he acknowledge him?
Yeah. He was like, look at that. So that was kind of cool.
Mm. What's your friend's name?
Chankton. Charlie Acton. Chankton.
And was he like, Chankton?
No, he didn't know. He didn't know him.
Where's Wu-Tang?
Yeah.
I have a couple of questions for you. The one is for the both of you.
Yeah.
So Digman, he's a world traveler, explorer.
And by the way, Mitch is also a voice on Digman.
I am a voice on Digman.
That's right.
I had a blast doing it. I don't know how the ratings for my specific moment were, but hopefully I hope they were good.
Yeah. The paddles went through the roof.
So two questions. One, did you like my Donnie Brasco meets Donnie Darko thing? And two, if you could take any sort of food from around the globe and make it something that's more readily available in the States, like Digman is a world traveler, so you know, like I'm saying, like some sort of food from a different country, and make it more readily available in the U.S., what would it be?
Mm.
That's a good question.
Okay, I can start. I didn't like your impression; it was lazy. And it didn't work. and then. I recently was in Greece, and when I was going there, my friend Akiva was like, oh, I went to Greece last year. You got to get Mamos beer.
Oh, okay. Wow.
And Phillips was there.
Oh, wow.
And me and Phillips got a bunch of Mamos beer, and I will say we enjoyed it quite a bit. And now that I'm here, I'm like, I can go for an ice cold Mamos.
Right, what is it? Is it like a Pilsner? What kind of a beer is it?
Greek.
Okay. So like a lighter beer, darker beer?
It's like a tzatziki.
That's making me think
it's
of
lighter.
Me,
yeah, it's lighter.
A lighter. Okay.
Yeah.
That's making me think just of something else from the continent that you know. And I've never crossed an ocean, but I've read about the notion of the French tacos, which is completely foreign from our idea of a taco. It's like an Algerian dish. And it's Algerian like you know wrapped flatbread that's got like you know fries and like cheese and like halal meat in it. Sounds great. I was like, I'd love to have some French tacos if they're available stateside. So I guess that would be my answer.
That's pretty good. Yeah. I wasn't asking you, but go, Neil. What's your
and also, you know, when I lived in Japan, I loved soba, hot and cold.
Oh yeah, sure.
And that was something we moved back to the States and would go get the ingredients to make it at from like Asian markets and stuff like that, and really loved soba. And so I remember like also liking ramen fine, but like loving soba. And so it's. As I've grown older and like there are ramen shops all around, I'm like, I kind of wish there were soba shops more than ramen shops.
Yeah, you can find some, but that's not as much of like a thing available.
So if the question is, what do I wish there was more of? Like, I know there is, definitely some, but I wish soba was more readily available in the U.S.
How much do you wish? Like so
like,
bad.
Like, yeah, I would so like, bad. Do anything.
So bad. Do you wish so bad? Do you wish so bad?
I'd do it. I'd give it all up.
Okay, great.
You give it all up. Both of you didn't answer the second part of the question, but that's okay.
Did you have something in mind when you asked this? A world delicacy that you wish was more readily available stateside?
No.
Okay.
He's just hung up on the Brasco Darko thing.
Yeah, you guys, neither of you answered that, yeah. But that's okay.
It's a thinker. I gotta kind of like.
Yeah, okay, that's fair. I like that answer. A toasty. I like the toasties that I got in Ireland. I like those quite a bit.
Okay.
Which they kind of do have here, but they were like such a specific taste to them. I don't know.
I think the issue might be that Brasco and Darko are similarly kind of like in the same tone.
Yeah.
You know, even though one's a little bit more horror and abstract and a thinker and the other one's more mob movie. It's like I feel like if you had something that was rubbed against it more like a Donny Osmond, you know, Osmond, Brasco or something. I don't know.
Yeah,
like, this is an area.
I don't know if Brasco, Darko would like qualify you for like a Family Guy flashback or something.
Next, on your return visit to Doughboys, I will have it nailed down.
Okay, great.
Okay, would you try it again now?
Geez Louise, I'm going undercover and there's a rabbit over there.
Yeah. Okay. I think, Mitch...
It felt similar the first time. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, look.
I think the thing that would help you is getting the Family Guy flashback in your bones. So maybe if you start with Peter Griffin, like, saying, that reminds me of the time.
Oh, yeah. That reminds me of the time Donnie Brasco met Donnie Darko.
There you go.
Yeah.
Does it? Hey, the pilot of Brooklyn Nine-Nine begins with you quoting Donnie Brasco, right?
It does.
Doesn't it?
Oh, well, well, well. We're not too high above it anymore, eh?
I didn't write it.
By the way, I did the Donnie Brasco meets Donnie Darko thing at a live show, and it bombed then.
But I didn't know this has been in the works. You've been like testing it out.
Why did you bring it
back? I gotta
say,
I'm pretty surprised you guys didn't like it, because I tried it live, and it ain't shit. And I put even less effort into it then.
I have, before we get to our final segment,
yes.
Which we're sorry that we've wasted so much of your time. In general,
we like it.
A very famous early Lonely Island sketch where you mention what your movie food order is.
Mm-hmm.
And you told me beforehand that that's not really what you eat at the movie theater.
Mr. Pibb and Red Vines is not my order.
It's not your order. What
Akiva wrote that line, and I think there's a good chance that that is what Akiva likes.
Wow,
that's pretty interesting. I'm a Twizzlers man over Red Vines personally.
Yeah, I mean, I was pretty shocked. It might have just been that we all think that saying Mr. Pibb is funny.
It's funny, yeah.
It's Mr. Pibb.
And Mr. Pibb is, we're both fans of Mr. Pibb. It's a very good soda.
He's lost the Mr. Now it's Pibb Extra. Yeah. You can find vanilla Mr. Pibb anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Damn.
What is your go-to movie order when you go to the movies? And you as well, Neil, someone who goes to quite a few movies.
Sure. You're not talking about like a ticket.
No, I mean, outside of the actual purchase of the ticket.
Okay.
Yeah.
What food would you order?
For me, I would get a big, like, ice cold, either Coke, classic, or like a Sprite.
Yeah.
And then big old popcorn, butter in the middle, and then a box of Junior Mints I dump in the popcorn.
Wow. Okay. So you do the mix.
Yeah.
Salty and
a Coca-Cola
sweet.
Most people do a different candy than that.
Mm-hmm.
It's the classic one is
peanut M&Ms or M&Ms. Yeah.
Or Whoppers.
Whoppers. Whoppers are big.
I just love Junior Mints, so I mix those together and it works for me.
Whopper candies, to be clear.
Not your dad's nickname.
What's that? I would do a cherry Coke sometimes. That was more at
had a cherry Coke, I would do it. Yeah. That's I didn't know that was on the table.
Sorry. This dream scenario, you can have any soda.
At Arclight, Arclight famously had a cherry Coke dispenser. The freestyle machine is not as good. Neil, what are your answers?
You know, I feel like I do always just get popcorn, and sometimes I'm in line. I'm like, what's just something else I can get that I'm going to be even more excited about? And then I get up, and I'm like, there really isn't anything. I don't want the candies or anything. I'm like, it's just popcorn. But I like places like Metrograph in New York has like kind of a sort of seasoned popcorn. What's in it that I think is very good, and Nighthawk and stuff. So I'd say I like when there's kind of a fun little twist on popcorn.
I worked at a movie theater in college and they had Lowry's seasoned salt packets the counter.
That
works in popcorn really well.
I worked at a movie theater. I worked at a General Cinema in Braintree. I was a movie.
I was a UA in Santa Cruz.
I always wanted to, but I worked at Pizza Hut.
What's everyone's pacing for?
That's where the score comes from.
Yeah, revenge.
What's everyone's pacing for consuming snacks during a movie? Because my problem is I get the nachos, and then I'm done with my whole tray before the trailers are over.
I eat it all immediately and then watch the movie.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I do.
I usually get a popcorn I couldn't possibly finish, and then I'm kind of chowing down. Yeah, I sometimes try to, like, I'm like, okay, no more bites, this trailer. And then, then by 10 minutes into the movie, I've stopped eating.
My mom would go to the movies as a family, and my mom would be like, let's just get one and we'll share it. And then the whole movie, you're like waiting.
Yeah,
it's
it
like
sucks.
Passing it back and forth. And
that's
just like,
bullshit.
Would you ever do the popcorn trick?
With my family? That's where Dick in a Box comes from. Literally, it's Yorma being like, what about that thing from Diner?
Oh, wow. Like, wow.
Done. Yeah.
That's some mom bullshit. I don't like that. A thing that I've been doing recently, well, mom's trying to pull bullshit like that, and I'm just calling
sometimes
them out on
trying
it.
To save a little bit of money.
With our mom, we were so grateful to just get anything because she's like going to the natural store and bring home carob clusters. And
man.
Right.
They taste like chocolate.
My friend's mom would make popcorn bring to the movie, which I was going to say why, because that's what I've been doing a lot lately is I popped my own popcorn at the house now.
That's right. That's a lot of fun.
I got popcorn, and I was trying to think of the name of the salt. There's a good salt to use. Yeah. The name.
What kind of device are you using to pop it?
It's like an air. I don't know. I got it on a Instacart. The guy brought it to me, and I've got corn. I got corn with it. Corn kernels with it.
Story's falling apart.
I did get it. It's some sort of popping machine. I know that. I can look it up. I'll look it up, but we got to get to the segment.
Yeah, let's do our segment. Yeah. Okay, so we'll need our headphones for this. I've got some food-related jingles, and Mitch and our guests must determine which year they came out.
Ooh.
It's another edition of Jingle All the Way, way spelled W-H-E-Y. These are compiled by our friend, the Drop King, Robert Persinger. The rules of Jingle All the Way, as I grab my own headphones. The closest guest, without going over, wins a point. If you guess the year exactly, you get 2 points. That's the Arden Marine rule. And if the game ends in a tie, the guest or guests win. That's the Mitch Kenna rule.
So you want to underguess the year?
Yeah, it's kind of Price is Right style.
I don't like that rule, but, you know, it is what it is.
Well, again, as we've established, guests can introduce additional rules. So if that ends up happening, we can amend how we play this game.
Right.
So today the theme is ice cream jingles. And the first one is from Dairy Queen. This is We Treat You Right.
And what year is it?
That's what you're going to guess.
Oh.
In the land of Dairy Queen, we treat you right.
Come to where hot fudge falls thick and rich. Peanuts are fresh and crunchy and all is cool and creamy.
Come discover the one place where good taste comes through.
Discover the Dairy Queen Peanut Buster Parfait.
In the land of Dairy Queen, we treat you right.
I do love that Peanut Buster Parfait. That's a great parfait. That's some nice food photography there. It kind of looked like we were going through canyons, but it ended up being within a Sunday. All right, Mitch, do you want to start?
Yes.
We'll take turns going in
I found the popcorn maker.
Okay, great.
It was a Dash popcorn maker.
Oh.
Dash popcorn maker.
Incredibles.
Like, made by DoorDash.
made by DoorDash. Yeah. And then and then Malden, you know the salt Malden?
Yeah.
You put some malt. Who's it? You put some Malden salt on there and it's good.
Nice.
And some butter. Anyways, I'm gonna go. This is an 80s ad to me, Wax. Maybe it's 70s.
Okay.
But I would say late 70s, early 80s. I'm gonna go the year I was born, 1982.
Mitch is going with 1982.
Is that too early?
We're going to find out. Neil, what year do you think this Dairy Queen spot
This feels
released?
A little like maybe it came after the Share a Coke thing. So I'm going to go, I'll go 74, Godfather 2 year.
1974.
I was going to go 80s, but then the music kicked in the back third of it that was very disco.
Yes.
And it made me think this was late 70s, and I'm tempted to go with the year I was born, 78, but if it's 77, I'll kill myself. So I'm going to say 77.
Andy, you're going to win this because it actually came out as late as 1981, if you can believe that.
Wow.
That's a thing that I think we found, Mitch, with these spots.
I was a year away.
They're always, but you were over. They're always like a... They are always a little bit behind pop culture, it feels like. They're chasing the trends a little bit. But yeah, 1981 is the answer. Andy gets a point.
I've had an ice cream stain on my finger the entire episode. I don't know if anyone noticed that.
I thought that was just your finger.
Dan Padley's going to notice.
We didn't talk about how dope of a name Dan Padley is.
It's a good name.
Yeah.
Great name.
Actually, is my finger bruised?
That's what I thought.
It might be.
I was staring at that finger the whole time.
All right, let's play the next one. The next one is Baskin-Robbins.
I'll make him a Sunday.
The spot is called Dig In, Dig In. All right. Hey, Dig In, Dig In. How about that?
Hey.
Yeah, it's like Digman. The song being popular.
Perhaps a clue with the styling of the caricatures at the end. Oh, and then the little call sign.
Ooh, and that's actually pretty advanced graphics there.
Yeah, it kind of looks like a bit of a 3D treatment.
We're going in the same order?
We're gonna mix up the order, so Neil, you'll start this time.
Okay. You know, Baskin-Robbins was, if I got a good report card, that was my treat. That was our local, too,
Baskin-Robbins.
Sometimes I get ice cream anyway, but I could get, like, a special, like, a brownie sundae. If my grades were good. I'm gonna go 77 this time.
1977. Andy, what say you?
I thought the style of photography in it was distinctively 80s. Mm. But I don't want to overshoot it.
Mm.
If I was trying to guess it on the nose, I'd say 84, but I'm going to say 82 this time.
1982.
That's the year of my birth.
Mm. Yes, I know that now.
I'm going to go earlier than both of you.
Wow.
Maybe surprisingly earlier.
Wow.
1922.
Wow. I thought you were going to say 1876.
Andy is going to win this again.
Wow. Oh my God.
I think you're all going to be shocked to hear this came out in 1987.
Wow.
My original guess was 84.
You know what? I should have. The graphic being sort of a 3D graphic should have. Yeah.
A little bit
off.
Of a. Yeah, little bit of a clue.
In the 20s, they didn't have too many 3D graphics either.
No, yeah. That's why there's no reference to a 3D graphic in The Great Gatsby.
The next spot is another Dairy Queen. This is Meet Me at DQ.
Meet me where it always feels like summertime. Swing a wheel upon the lake, just riding down. It's all about reunions and there's one around the bend. Meet me at the Dairy Queen, where the feeling never ends. Meet me at DQ.
Heard about America's Backyard Reunion? Come in and get an ultimate super value meal for only $2.99.
Come on to that feeling and meet me at DQ.
A lot of it's just Americana B-roll throughout there.
Yeah, really like Mellencamp-y.
Yes.
Tone, yeah.
All right, Andy, you will begin this time.
I liked America when it was like that.
The craziest thing about that song. The craziest thing about that song, which is a dumpster fire.
Yeah.
Is it actually shares almost a melody with a really great Joanna Sternberg song.
Whoa.
Anyway, I'm going to say 96.
1996.
Ooh. My reasons are my own.
Spoonman, what do you think?
As far back as I can remember, I liked ice cream, I said. I'm going to go
with... You did say that.
The year that... Goodfellas was made and then nominated for Best Picture in 1990.
What won over Goodfellas?
1990 is Dances with Wolves.
Yeah. Oh, right. Mm. Okay.
Aged
yeah.
well.
All right, Neil, what do you think?
93, I'll say.
1993. Sandberg is killing it here.
Yay!
Gonna win this one. Yeah. This ad came out. If you can believe it, 1999.
That's insane.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was right before Y2K.
Yeah, come to think of it, it was right before Y2K.
Yeah.
That's wild.
Did that commercial come out on New Year's Eve?
The next one is from Friendly's, New England chain. This is called Summertime is a Friendly's Time.
Ooh, I got a one up here. Okay.
Summertime is a friendly's time. An easy time, a friendly's time. Summertime is a friendly's time. Summertime is here.
Now at Friendly's, you can enjoy the world's best three-scoop ice cream sundae for just $1.99 and our famous ice cream or frozen yogurt cone for just 99 cents. $1.99 sundaes and 99 cent cones at Friendly's.
Neil, Andy, have you ever had Friendly's? Because I would not have had it had it not been for a tour show for this podcast.
I think I have in my life. But yeah. No, it's not ever been in like the rotation.
Yeah, yeah, I'll take you.
I've never had it.
Yeah.
I'm familiar with the chain.
You know, a lot of the, I don't know if you'll share the clip on the video feed, but yeah. A lot of the like shots there, the B-roll kind of things where you could have put into like, if you're doing the gag of like people are starting to have sex.
Oh yeah, right.
There it was like a lot of like a flower blooming yeah. And like that's a you know syrup
deluge of
dripping
water.
All over
yeah,
a
right.
thing. Yeah.
I was wondering why I was getting so horny over here.
Yeah. There's that one shot of that bronzed horse.
Mitch, you're guessing first here.
I'm gonna go with the Celtics were still, you know, they were still hot. Larry Bird is in his last, you know, like 88 is what I was going to say. 1988. 86 was the last time they won with Bird, right? Or did they win in 88?
I'm trying to remember the sequence. I guess you know this as a Lakers fan. 86, 87, I believe, was the Lakers' most dominant series. And they think they went back-to-back in 87, 88. I think the Celtics won 85, 86.
Yeah.
That was the great Celtics team. Or the best of those three championships. Neil, what do you want to say here?
I'm gonna say 2005.
2005. Okay.
Really?
I got to take some risk here. I don't know. I gotta win.
And it's anyone's game because of the Arden Marine rule. If we get it on the dot, you get 2 points. So anyone can cut into Andy's lead.
Andy gets it on the dot, then we're fucked.
That's true. Andy, what do you think?
I was gonna say 85.
1985 is the guess.
If it's 2005, I'm going to shit.
You're not going to shit because it came out in 1996, which means Mitch wins it.
Yes. I'm on the board.
Mitch is on the board. And let's see. Wait, how many? I think we have
that
one left.
That song was bad.
Yeah, it was.
It was like someone like riffing.
Yeah.
Summertime is a friendly's time. It's a friendly's time. It's a friendly's time. It's like, and like Michael Jackson was just like humming. He hadn't written the words yet in his demos. Friendly's time.
We have one left. So this one will decide this game. This is another Dairy Queen ad. This is that's what I like about Texas.
What was the year of the last one?
About Texas, at one point we were our own country. Remember the Alamo? Mm. And the world's first rodeo was right here in Pecos, Texas. Huh. Know what else I like? Right now at DQ, I can get a steak finger country basket or a delicious dude combo with a drink and fries for just $5. And check it out, the pumpkin pie blizzard is back. Dude, you know you want one. DQ, that's what I like.
So definitely the most modern are the ones we've seen, the URL at the end, the social media graphics. However, it's still in the 4:3 aspect ratio, so seems to predate HD. At least those are you know, clues I'm catching. Who started last time?
I started last time.
Okay, so Neil, you're up.
What was the answer for the last one?
It was 1996.
One. Wow, that was so much later than
my guess is going to be. It's before Obama was like that. That is a George W. Bush era ad campaign. So I'm gonna go. 2006.
I'm just kind of floored finding out that the D in DQ stands for dude. That was an ad that was not, I didn't know those existed.
No, me neither.
How about,
like, you mean like savory menu items?
No, just the Texas.
Oh, just the Texas theme.
So directed only at one area.
Yes, right.
Like, there's never like a California one of those for McDonald's or something. Where
no, not really.
Welcome to California. I guess DQ's big in Texas.
Apparently.
The guy kind of looked like Adam Scott also, right?
He did look a little bit like, yeah. Looked like a thick Adam Scott.
This was kind of the prequel to Severance.
This is kind of...
I'm stalling. I don't have a good guess. I think, what did you say, 2005?
2006, I believe.
Six, yeah.
I'm going to say 2005.
2005, wow.
The year I graduated college. There is social media stuff on there, like you said.
Yes.
Oh, it might be later.
Which is Mike Flagg just fell off again.
You know, it's just not my day today. It hit my dick. I didn't react.
It's a dead zone. Too much ice cream.
Oh, boy. I'm going to go, it's not 2001, but that covers everything before it. I'm going to say 2001, the year I graduated high school.
Everyone is going to end up on the board, but Andy is going to win. Neil takes this one because this one came out, if you can believe it, in Obama's second term, 2013.
Wow.
I can believe it.
I can believe it.
Yeah.
I just thought it was like, we all love W and here's the, now we love Texas.
It was more, we hate Obama.
Yeah,
more
reaction. Yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
That explains some of the separatist sentiment. All right. Hey, that was our, Jingle All the Way, spelled W-H-E-Y, just like a restaurant value feedback. Let's open up the feedback. Today's email is from Luke M. Luke writes, if you could only eat foods that start with one letter of the English alphabet, what letter are you going with?
Oh.
P.
P for me. Did you say P?
Yeah, P.
Why P?
Pizza, pasta,
popcorn.
Mm-hmm.
Paninis.
Yes.
I got a different one.
Yeah.
Pussy. So can you say pussy?
Yes.
Oh, pussy.
Sushi, spaghetti.
No.
Also, is great. Penis for rodeo.
Penis.
Yeah, rodeo.
Penis. Pussy. Penis. Yeah.
Are you down with OPP?
Pony penis.
Pony penis.
Pony penis.
Not a pee. No pee for you.
No, sushi, scallops, spaghetti.
Oh, yeah,
it's kind of almost like I wonder if the way is to work backward from one thing that you can anchor a bunch of things. Like I was almost just thinking B immediately because that gives you bread, and then with bread you have a lot of leeway. And
bread, beans, burritos,
right? Yeah, bread, yeah. Beef, burrito. You know, bananas, berries, mm-hmm. Bratwurst.
I sound like the pea Nazi. I said no pea for you. I don't know if you heard it. Andy, do you have an answer?
Z.
Okay.
Yeah.
Zucchini, ziti.
Zucchini, ziti, zargnuts.
Right.
Zargnuts.
Covers a lot.
Zazzles.
Zazzles are big.
Yeah.
There's a case for.
I think he might be a Martian.
No.
Zimbal flam. Zord burgers.
Don't get me started on Zord burgers.
I think B is pretty good.
B is good.
Too.
There's a case for C as well. Cause like, you know, you get chicken, you get cheese, you get chips and crackers.
And
those are both good.
And the C word.
Yeah, you get the C word, yeah.
But B, you get butthole.
Yeah.
B,
that's
you get
true.
Butthole.
Yeah.
C is the cum. We're thinking
cum. You get cum.
We're thinking cum. We're thinking
right?
cum.
Yeah.
Well, you don't, because your wife is bronze.
I'm just thinking this will probably be our most listened to episode.
I'm so sorry. Your husband.
My husband. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right. My husband. Yeah.
Apologies.
Sorry, rodeo.
Yeah.
It also depends on how do you want to include categories? Like, does seed get you cruciferous vegetables? Or is that like kind of like,
that's
you're
cheating.
Not, that's what I was going to say. That maybe is against the spirit of the game.
Only Luke M. can answer that question.
That's true.
That's a good point. You know, I pick F, food. Yeah. How's that?
Fuck you!
Yeah, that's the genie for more wishes, motherfucker.
Food and fountain sodas. I'm pretty good to go.
Yeah.
What do you think of that?
Fudge.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you guys laughed at me the whole episode, and now I'm showing you what's up.
Yeah.
It's true. You've really put us on our place.
Which kind of won the episode, I guess, in the end.
Yeah.
We
food.
Lost, he won.
Oh, yeah. By the way, someone wins the episode at the end of every Doughboy.
Oh, what do you get?
You get to take home with that the
Duwanta?
Duwanta. Duwanta cake.
It's not supposed to rhyme with Santa, right? It's Duwanta.
Let us know what you think with hashtag MyFoodLetter. And if you have a question or comment about the world of chain restaurants, you can email us at doughboyspodcast@gmail.com or leave us a voicemail at 830-GO-DOUGH. That's 830-463-6844. And you can get the Doughboys Double, our weekly bonus episode, by joining the Golden or Platinum Play Club at patreon.com/doughboys. Neil Campbell, Andy Samberg, Digman, now on Paramount Plus. Very, very funny show.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
On
Thank
it.
You.
People
we
should check it
hope
out.
Hope people laugh at it. That's what we try to do.
It's unbleeped, streaming unbleeped.
Oh, yeah.
If you didn't catch it when it was on Comedy Central, which you should have, you fucking idiots.
Yeah, but if you're one of those crazy people that doesn't DVR a weekly show on cable and you're waiting for the streaming, you are in luck. It's streaming now on Paramount Plus.
Check it out. It's fantastic. Two of the funniest people around. My mentor, in many ways. Should I not say that? Is that bad for you?
I wish you'd say more.
What an honor to have two of the funniest
such
people.
Thank you, guys.
Treat. Congrats
love,
on the show.
Love the show.
Hope people check
so
it out.
So glad to have done it. And the ice cream was delicious.
Yeah.
Oh, there you
yeah,
go.
Thank
Do
you
I
for...
need to give somebody money for it? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything else you want to plug or anything else you want to tell us about the show?
Okay.
How about human kindness?
Yes.
Did anyone ever think about that? Now, can I stand with this?
Yeah.
Wow. All right. Well, then that'll do it for this episode of Doughboys. Until next time, for the Spoon Man, Mike Mitchell, I'm Nick Weiger. Happy eating.
School's out, Wags. See ya.
Wow.
Bye.
Hey, buddy, it's Weiger. Breaking Chews. Get Played, the video game podcast I co-host with Heather Ann Campbell and Matt Apodaca, is now right here on HeadGum. Listen to Heather, Matt, and me, Wigs, talk about good games, bad games, and every game in between every Monday. Get Played on HeadGum. Subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Wow. Sources for the intro are in the episode description.
That was a HeadGum podcast.